For the last Proverbs class, my intention was to combine lesson 11 and lesson 12. So for lesson 11, which is the ABCs of an excellent wife, this is Proverbs 31 verses 10 through 31. It is sometimes considered to be part of the words of King Lemuel, the words that his mother taught him. That's chapter 31 and verse 1. But then again, it probably isn't. The reason is, first of all, it's a standalone section. Each of the opening lines is a successive letter of the Hebrew alphabet. It's something we call an acrostic. It's just kind of an interesting poetic structure that you find here and there in the Hebrew Bible, but it definitely shows that those verses belong as a unit. It's something that the writer did on purpose in order to package them together as an acrostic. The other thing is that in the Septuagint version of the book of Proverbs, which is the version of the Old Testament mostly used by New Testament writers, it's not found here. It's actually found 5 chapters earlier in the book of Proverbs, kind of separating it from the words of King Lemuel's mother. So it might be true that this section was taught to King Lemuel by his mother, but probably not. It probably belongs all by itself. It's a package all by itself. So what you want to do, what we would have done in class, is to read all the way through and just kind of make some comments at each point as we go along. I'm not going to read it on screen because I think you'll do a better job of that yourself. But I do want to point out a few things to prepare you for reading. Just kind of be thinking about bringing up all of the imagery and all of the examples from their agrarian ancient context into kind of a modern context. And what I would suggest is, for example, you'll see sowing happening quite a lot in this proverb. Well, people don't really sow anymore. In fact, it's not even economically viable to sow anymore. I mean, it used to be that housewives would sew clothing because that was the cheapest way to make clothing. Well, we learned several years ago that that's not the cheapest way to get clothing. That actually takes a very long time and can be kind of expensive. You do a better job shopping at the 70% off clearance rack at Dillard's, or even going to a thrift store. That's going to be the cheapest way to get clothing. That doesn't mean that the idea of the worthy woman who would sew clothes is outdated and meaningless. It just means to view it in terms of efficiency and being thrifty and various ways to contribute to one's family, whatever the historical context demands, that keeps the family going. So be thinking of those images in a modern context. Notice that her worth is far above jewels, that her character and her behavior and her contributions to the family are very important. Notice in verses 11 and 12 the trust that her husband has in her. Notice that in verses 13 through 15, she takes a lot of delight in what she does for her family. She enjoys being a wife and a mother, and that uplifting spirit uplifts those around her. Notice in verse 16, she's a very responsible person. She actually uses the family money in order to buy a field and to make a profit for it. This whole idea of whether or not a woman could or should work outside of the home today, that's for each family to decide, of course. But obviously, this woman was contributing in various ways, even financially, to her household. And she was responsible for those areas. In verse 20, you can see the kinds of help she gives, not just to her own family, but to people outside her family. She is involved in charity and good works and helping those who are less fortunate. Verses 21 and 22, she is not afraid of the snow because she's prepared. Now, it didn't snow a lot in Palestine. It did every once in a while, which just emphasizes the point that she was caught off guard by nothing. Even things that wouldn't happen all that frequently, she was still ready to meet those challenges because she was prepared for them. You'll notice that she makes some time for herself as well in making good things and enjoyable things for herself. Verse 26, you'll see that she teaches, that the teaching of kindness is on her tongue, and she teaches God's word. likely to other women and to her children. And then verses 28 through 31, you'll notice that she deserves every bit of the praise that she receives and more, that her husband and her children really need to realize what an important gift God has given to them in this worthy woman and tell her over and over and over. Husbands need to constantly boost the self-esteem of their wives, because you got to remember, in the work world, husbands, you get promotions when you do a good job. You get recognition, you get gold watches, but what does your wife get for working super hard each and every day all throughout her life? She needs to receive praise and recognition also. All right, so read that section on your own and think about it, maybe talk about it with your own family, and then I'm going to pause and we'll do the last lesson. All right, and then here's the last lesson, lesson number 12, which is where I stuffed every proverb that didn't fit other places in the lesson book. Some of these go together and some of them are just all by themselves. So the first three proverbs are about the way of God. Proverbs 3 and verse 5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding." Be sure that we don't use our feelings or just our untrained conscience to make our decision. We need to trust God and his word in order to make those decisions. Same thing with Proverbs 14:12. "There is a way which seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death." And then Proverbs 13, verses 14 through 15, "The teaching of the wise is a fountain of life, to turn aside from the snares of death. Good understanding produces favor, but the way of the treacherous is hard." And sometimes that's a truth that we fail to reckon with, that if we insist on bad behavior, it's going to make our lives more difficult. And people who insist on violating God's word sometimes receive the consequences of their actions. The way of the treacherous is hard. I actually have a friend of mine who got the permission of the family to read this proverb at the funeral of someone who had died because of drug addiction. And the family wanted everybody else in the audience to realize that he did not live a very good life. It was a hard life with a lot of sickness and disease and difficulty and financial ruin, because he refused to listen to God on the subject of his addiction. Anyway, the next section is what I've called numerical proverbs. These are kind of all mostly heaped up at the very end, although there's one in chapter 6. Let's just look at the first one to see what we're talking about here. Proverbs 6 and verses 16 through 19. Proverbs 6, 16 through 19 says, "There are six things which the Lord hates, yes, seven which are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that run rapidly to evil, a false witness who utters lies, and one who spreads strife among brothers." So what the proverb writer has done, that put together a bunch of separate topics all under one heading of things that God hates. And the way he introduces it by saying there are six things that God hates, yes, seven, is to say this is a fairly long list, but it is not an exhaustive list. It's not that he couldn't figure out how many fingers he had, six or seven that he was holding up, but the idea is here's a bunch and there's probably a lot more that go along with this. Indeed, the things that you find on this list, each and every one of them, we need to reckon with to realize that prideful looks, lies, hands that shed innocent blood, etc., all the way through to the end, are things that when God sees, he abhors them. The other things that are on the list on the book take us to Proverbs 30. So what you'll want to do is actually turn all the way back to Proverbs 30. And we're just going to look at these briefly in turn. Proverbs 30, verses 15 through 16. Actually, the first one I dealt with in a different place. It is, "The leech has two daughters. Give, give." And that's just kind of funny. But the next part, There are three things that will not be satisfied, four that will not say enough. Sheol, which is the Hebrew idea of Hades, it's the unseen realm of the dead. Sheol, the barren womb, earth that is never satisfied with water, and fire that never says enough. Indeed, those are four things that are never satisfied. Next are four things that are too wonderful to understand. And that starts in verse 18. Three things which are too wonderful for me, four which I do not understand. The way of the eagle in the sky, the way of a serpent on a rock, the way of a ship in the middle of a sea, and the way of a man with a maid. Obviously, these are all things that we could explain scientifically, but that's not the idea. It's that the proverb writer is saying that creation is full of amazing things and unexplainable things. God's created a wonderful world. The last one is the kicker, though. It's funny to think about human relationships in the same category as I can't figure out how that eagle can stay up in the air. Four things that make the earth quake, Proverbs 30, verses 21 through 23. Under three things, the earth quakes, and under four, it cannot bear up. Under a slave, when he becomes king, and a fool, when he is satisfied with food. Under an unloved woman, when she gets a husband, and a maidservant, when she supplants her mistress. Again, not a great monumental deal there, but just saying that when the world and its structures get turned upside down, sometimes bad things happen. Four things that are small but wise in Proverbs 30 and verses 24 through 28. That four things are small on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. The ants are not a strong people, but they prepare their food in the summer. The Shephanim are not mighty people, yet they make their houses in the rocks. There's some reason that's transliterated is that there's some question as to the actual animal or people that are involved there. The locusts have no king, yet all of them go out in ranks. The lizard you may grasp with the hands, yet it is in king's palaces. The idea that this is a small creature, but it still finds its way into important places. I have to sneeze. I didn't do that on screen, so that's good. And then finally, four things stately in their march, Proverbs 30, verses 29 through 31. It says, the lion which is mighty among beasts and does not retreat before any, the strutting rooster, the male goat also, and a king when his army is with him. Boy, he feels like he can take on the whole world when he's surrounded by his army. So on the final page, we've got a number of other miscellaneous things. National righteousness. This is a standalone proverb. It doesn't go in any other category, but boy, is it true. And we could consider the United States of America with this. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a disgrace or a reproach, depending on your translation, to any people. Proverbs 14 and verse 34. It's never a bad policy to pursue God's righteousness in a nation. Proverbs 22 and verse 1 says, a good name is more desirable than great wealth. Favor is better than silver and gold. Better to have a good reputation than to have a bunch of money. And then the final five Proverbs all talk about the watchfulness of God. Proverbs 15:3, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, watching the evil and the good. Proverbs 15:11, Sheol and Abaddon lie open before the Lord. How much more the hearts of men? If God can see into the unseen realm of the dead and into destruction, then of course he can see into our individual hearts. Proverbs 20 and verse 12, the hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord has made both of them. So if we think that we can see and hear a lot and know a lot, we have to remember that we have a God who created those senses in our brains. Proverbs 23, 10 through 11 says, do not move the ancient boundary or go into the fields of the fatherless, for their Redeemer is strong, and he will plead their case against you. What's going on here? This needs a little explanation. Is in the ancient world, the plots of land, especially the tribal inheritances, were divided up by stones that were put in the ground, and they weren't to be moved. And normally you couldn't get away with that if You wanted a couple extra rows of your neighbor's farmland. If you went over there and you moved the rock, he'd know that pretty quickly and there'd be a fight. And so you wouldn't try that. But what if something bad happened in their family that took them away for a while? Or what if the father passed away? Then a greedy neighbor could move the ancient landmark and they might not notice for a while. That might not be something that's in their mind. They might not be concerned about it. They might not notice for several years. And then all of a sudden you've grabbed up extra property. But they would figure it out eventually, and even though they had no power to change it, they would call out to God, and God would be angry. So don't take advantage of your neighbor in a bad time, is what that's saying. Do the right thing all the time, or else he's going to plead to God for relief, and God is a powerful redeemer for those who are down on those who are suffering. And finally, the very last one, Proverbs 24 and verse 11. Deliver those who are being taken away to death and those who are staggering to slaughter. Oh, hold them back. If you say, see, we did not know this, does he not consider it, he who weighs the hearts? And does he not know it who keeps your soul? Will he not render to man according to his work? It's kind of a sad image here. This is injustice that's happening in the land. This is when we see bad things going on, the innocent are being drug away to slaughter. And if we just sit back and say, oh, I didn't know what was going on. I didn't realize there was a problem. God says, yes, he knows what's in our hearts, and he's not going to let us get away with that. So we need to stand up for the rights of the afflicted and speak up when we see injustice taking place. Thank you so much for your attention.